What's good, y'all? Let's continue our work exploring how MATLAB functions. In this video, let's talk about how to define row vectors. Let's start by exploring a formal definition of what a row vector is. In this case, we'll start with the column dimension of our vector. In other words, we'll say that n, lowercase n, as in November, is a natural number. That's a nerdy mathematical way of saying that n is a positive whole number, like 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way up to infinity. We're not sure exactly which one it is to begin with. We then say that a row vector x in R1 by n has n real valued entries organized in one row and n columns. This little blackboard R, that's what that's called with the double line, represents the real numbers. When we put this superscript 1 times n, that means that this bold-faced vector is going to have one row and n columns, where n is some natural number greater than or equal to 1. The vector itself, when we say it's organized in one row and n columns, so boldface x equals bracket x1, x2, all the way to xn. The individual entries, x1, x2, all the way to the last entry, xn, are scalar valued coefficients. We can see that they're scalar valued in our notation because they are non-boldface, whereas the vector x is in boldface. Notice that this vector is organized as a single row and each entry populates its own column. In other words, x1 is in column 1. x2 is in column 2, and we continue with an individual real valued entry all the way till we get to the last coefficient of that vector, which is x n, or the nth column of that row vector. When we use MATLAB to define row vectors, we use a very similar structure that we saw in column vectors. In other words, on the left-hand side of our assignment operator, we define a variable name. We then use the equal sign to say the variable we're defining is going to get the value on the right-hand side. We start our row vector definition with the left square bracket. We end it with the right square bracket. We type individual numeric scalars inside, delimited by commas. We know that x1 will be the first entry of our row vector. In other words, in row 1, column 1. The moment I type that little comma, that says, that is now the end of column 1, please move on to column 2. So x1 is the entry in column 1, comma, x2 is the entry in column 2, comma, all the way till we get to the last entry in our vector, which is xn, where we've used the n minus 1 commas to separate the individual columns of this row. Let's take a look at an example using some real-world data having to do with the population of the United States. In the bottom, we see a table that compares year to population in the United States. Let's go ahead and define a variable. We'll call it year. We're going to declare this as a row vector, so we immediately open and close the square brackets. Then we actually write the individual years inside by typing each individual year and separating them via comma. I like to use an extra space, which has no effect on MATLAB internally. Notice that when I push enter, MATLAB displays for me the 1x8 row vector that I've defined using this call. We can also define the population vector, which has to do with the second row of this table. We'll go ahead and do that individually. So we start with the vector name. We use the assignment operator. We immediately type the left and right bracket. We go back inside and type the individual entries separated by a comma. Now that we've typed the individual entries separated by comma for this row vector, I'm going to put a semicolon at the end to suppress my output. That means when I run it, MATLAB will store that variable internally, but will not display the output as I saw above. Let's take a look at another example. First, we'll clear our screen using CLC, and then we'll define a row vector T that is equally spaced. Perhaps we'll call it 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10. Push enter. I did want to call this out. I don't have to use commas to delimit the individual columns of a row vector. In fact, if I just use spaces, MATLAB will store the same vector. The reason that I like commas is sometimes it's not always clear when defining a large vector with spaces. It's kind of hard to read which one is which, especially this is especially true if you're using long strings of numbers. Whereas if I use space, comma, space, it's much easier to read where one entry begins and the other one ends. Notice that if you compare this call to this call, here we see a very, very clear pattern where the entry in the previous column ends and the next entry begins. That is why I recommend to my viewers use commas to delimit individual columns of a row vector as often as possible. In any case, when I push enter on this, MATLAB will store this as a 1x5 vector. The individual entries of this vector are the columns of that row. As you're following along with me at home, I hope you noticed that defining vectors by typing the individual entries kind of gives you a headache. It does for me anyways. It takes a lot of time. That's what we call the entry by entry definition, because we're literally defining the vectors entry by entry. In other videos, we're going to see how to leverage MATLAB functions to define long vectors with a small set of code, so you don't have to type in a bunch of data. We'll also learn how to use what they call the load function to bring data out of an Excel spreadsheet into the MATLAB workspace. However, to end this video, let's do a recap of the syntax we use to define row vectors. On the left-hand side of our definition, we're going to write a variable name, so a vector name. I recommend using lowercase letters for vectors. Then we're going to say that gets or becomes whatever we type on the right-hand side using the assignment operator or equal sign. The moment we start defining our vectors, we're going to use the left square bracket that says, please define a matrix for me. To close that matrix out, every left square bracket has to be matched by a right square bracket. In fact, let's go ahead and test this. Let's call a vector air and then just write 1, 2, 3, 4. If I do not close the right square bracket, MATLAB is going to assume that I want to continue typing this information in. Notice the moment that I close that out, MATLAB will show this statement is now closed. This becomes an issue if I were to type air 1, 2, 3, 4, and then for whatever reason, maybe I type like some other type of string, and then I use like a clear function or something like this, and then close it. MATLAB doesn't like that because the argument that I have in that first line has nothing to do with the stuff that's happening in the second line. The point of that is every time I write a left bracket, I should also write a right bracket to say in between are the individual entries of this row. After we've typed the left bracket, we're going to type the individual entries, which are scalar values. So the first entry in column 1, we type. I recommend for myself and for all of you viewers that you use commas in between the individual columns in a single row to make it super clear where one entry stops and the other one begins. You can also use spaces if you'd like. Either of them work. Having coded in MATLAB for many hours of my life, I found that this kind of is easier on the eyes for me to figure that out. When we're done typing those whole things, we can push enter. If we do not want to display the output in the command window, we can end this assignment with a semicolon, which suppresses that output. That ends this video on how to define row vectors in MATLAB. I'll see you in the next one, y'all.